Good morning. I'm here at the front doors of St. Thomas's. It's a cold, bright morning, and you can see the traffic reflected in the doors behind me. Have you ever wondered what a world without Jesus would be like? Without Jesus, the world would be very different. My friend Gerald and my friend Allison have both sort of been musing on that, and their reflection for this week addresses that subject. And I'll be back right after that to say good morning again and to introduce our service for this morning. Thank you for being with us, Allison and Gerald.
Not for him, every glimpse I dim. If not world stays broken. If not for him, every gloom how dims. If not for him, every sin remains unspoken. We are shattered and unchosen.
Past few years, St. Thomas's has been developing a series of hymns and readings that tells the story of salvation history, ending up exactly where the parable of the wicked tenants ends up. And in that parable, if you remember, the son is sent into the vineyard to collect the owner's due from the growing season, and they kill him and throw him out. And that is exactly, of course, what happened to Jesus in Jerusalem. The difference, I think, with this service primarily is that we have a narrator to string the various bits and pieces together. And I'm always amazed how many people say to me afterwards, at least with one of the segments, oh, you know, I've heard that so many times, but I didn't quite get how it fit into the big story. Obviously, I cannot take thousands and thousands of years to tell the story, but we'll do our best this morning to tell that story of salvation history. It's our story. It's the lore of Western civilization. It's the foundation of our legal system. It's what we understand to be the truth as Christians. Could we spend just a moment, please, and open with a couple of prayers? Let us pray. God of peace, we give you thanks for calling us together on this day to tell the story. And we ask you to help us forgive as we forgive each other for all the hurt and the brokenness brought into our lives. Let your healing love rest upon the wounds we have caused by our anger. Deepen our love in a new understanding for each other and for you. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, who carried on his cross our discord and our grief. Amen. O Lord our God, we thank you for all your blessings, for the story of salvation and all those who have partaken in it, for life and health, for laughter and fun, for all our powers of mind and body, for our homes and the love of dear ones, for everything that is beautiful, good, and true. But above all, we thank you for giving your Son to be our Savior and friend. May we always find our true happiness in pleasing you and helping others to know and love you. This we ask for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Listen now as the words of these scripture readings, the words of our narrator, and the words of the hymns all speak to us about our story.
The season of Lent is a journey in the wilderness. We come to know both the warm fellowship of those with us on the journey and the sharp reminders of Scripture as we ponder the demands of living a Christian life. Next Sunday, we will celebrate Palm Sunday and begin Holy Week. It is the most holy time of year for Christians. As we approach this sacred time, we pause to tell our Christian story. We tell it to remind ourselves of how God has worked through creation, history, and through the lives and witness of ordinary men and women to bring about salvation.
In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God separated the light from the darkness, and there was evening, and there was morning, the first day.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made.
Creation unfolded, the swirling universe expanded, and eventually this planet, our island home, came to be. Continents, oceans, forests, deserts, grasslands and valleys, the earth as we know it took shape. After many ages, living things crawled out of the oceans and flourished on dry land. Days and months, seasons and years melted into eons. Then one day, human life took shape in Africa, in what is now Kenya.
Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild things of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made. Indeed, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day.
Thus the heavens and the earth, and all the host of them, were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work.
Ancient scripture tells us that God created everything from nothing. It also tells us that Jesus, the eternal Word of God, existed with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit before creation began. Therefore, when we talk about God, we are talking about someone who exists beyond space and time as we know it. That can make it difficult to know God in the same way we know each other. But, as in every creative endeavor, there is something of the Maker in every part of creation. Christians see creation as a gift, and life here on earth an especially important gift to every human being. Yet, we must keep in mind that we are stewards of creation. Creation is given into our care. We do not own it. God's gift to human beings in creation was free will. What a wonderful gift to be able to make our own choices. Unfortunately, with the ability to make choices came the ability to make bad choices. Selfishness and greed crept in, and evil found a nesting place in God's creation. In fact, there was a time when there was so much evil in the world that God planned to wipe out all life with a great flood and start again. To preserve some of creation, God told Noah to build an ark, and Noah did as God commanded. Then the Lord said to Noah,
"Go into the ark, you and all your household, for I have seen that you alone are righteous before me in this generation. Take with you 7 pairs of all clean animals, the male and the female, and a pair of the animals that are not clean, and 7 pairs of the birds of the air also, male and female. For in 7 days I will send rain on the earth, and every living thing that I have made I will blot out from the face of the ground."
It rained for 40 days and 40 nights. When the rain stopped, Noah sent out birds from the ark to search for dry land. Eventually, the ark came to rest on Mount Ararat. Then God made a promise.
"This is the sign of the covenant I am making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth."
Ages passed. Children were born, grew old, and passed into eternity. Eventually, our human ancestors moved from Africa and spread throughout the earth. They varied in color, shape, and size. They spoke many languages and founded many cultures. In their busy lives, they forgot about God. Some worshiped objects and things. This displeased God, so God spoke to a man named Abram.
God said to Abram, "Get out of your country, from your family and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed."
Abraham and Sarah did as God asked. Because of that, and even though she was well beyond her childbearing years, Sarah had a son named Isaac. God renewed his promise to Isaac. Isaac had two sons of his own, Jacob and Esau. As brothers sometimes do, they fought. Jacob was jealous of his brother, and he stole his brother's inheritance. Esau was so angry at being cheated by his own brother that he was ready to kill him. Jacob had to get away. On the first night of his journey, alone in the wilderness, Jacob looked for a place to rest. Resting his head on a stone, Jacob lay down to sleep. That night he had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven. The angels of God were ascending and descending on the stairway.
Above the ladder stood the Lord, and he said, "I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you."
We have all been blessed through God's promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, for it was through this family that Jesus was eventually born. Jacob married and in time was reconciled with his brother. On the night before that reconciliation, Jacob struggled with an angel and injured his hip. After this struggle, the angel gave Jacob a new name, Israel, which means one who has struggled with God. Jacob eventually had 12 sons, and they became the founders of the 12 tribes of Israel. During a time of drought and famine, Jacob, who is now called Israel, moved his family to Egypt in search of food. They worked hard and became prosperous, so prosperous that the Egyptians became jealous of their prosperity. The Egyptians turned against the Israelites and made them slaves. But the Lord did not forget his people in their time of need.
And the Lord said to Moses, "I have come down to deliver my people out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Come, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? God said, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you, and that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, Indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, What is his name? What shall then I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. Thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you.
Pharaoh refused to let the people of Israel go. God became angry, and that anger was directed against the people of Egypt. Moses warned the people that a terrible thing was about to happen. But those who marked their doors with the blood of a lamb would escape God's anger. That night, the angel of the Lord came and took the life of every firstborn boy in Egypt. This was the first Passover, and Passover remains an important celebration in the Jewish calendar. It was this festival that Jesus was celebrating with his disciples at the Last Supper. Pharaoh relented and let the Israelites go. A huge procession of Israelites left Egypt. But after they left, Pharaoh changed his mind.
As they reached the Red Sea, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. Then the Lord said to Moses, Tell the Israelites to go forward, but you, lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground. Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Then the Lord said to Moses, Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers. So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers, and the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea. Not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians.
Israel traveled through the wilderness and came to Mount Sinai. There they worshiped just as God had said they would. It was at Mount Sinai that they were given the Ten Commandments, which still form a central part of our Judeo-Christian faith. After 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, the Israelites came to the land that the Lord had promised them. Yet, Israel's relationship with God was no different than ours. As so often happens, they forgot about God. Because they forgot the Lord, they were conquered by stronger nations and sent into exile in Babylon. They were emotionally and physically devastated. Listen to the words of the psalmist.
By the rivers of Babylon, we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. There on the poplars we hung our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors demanded songs of joy. They said, sing one of the songs of Zion. We answered, how can we sing songs of the Lord while in a foreign land? If I forget you, Jerusalem, may my right hand forget its skill. May my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you, if you do not consider Jerusalem my highest joy.
Yet, even in exile, the Lord comforted his people through the prophets. Listen to the words of the prophet Isaiah as God speaks through him to those who had been driven from their homes.
For a brief moment I abandoned you, but with great compassion I will gather you. In overflowing wrath, for a moment I hid my face from you, but with everlasting love I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. This is like the days of Noah to me, just as I swore that the waters of Noah would never again go over the earth. So I have sworn that I will not be angry with you and will not rebuke you. For the mountains may depart and the hills be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you, and my covenant of peace shall not be removed.
It was not just a return to their homes that God promised. God wanted them to come home spiritually as well. For to be in a relationship with God is to have that which the human soul needs most. Listen once more to the words of the prophet Isaiah.
Listen carefully to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, says the Lord. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the caterer, to the eater, so shall my word be that which goes out of my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it.
So shall my word be that which goes out from my mouth. Christians believe that the word Isaiah mentions is Jesus Christ, yet he is the Word of God in human form, the second person of the Holy Trinity. Yet, as we often find, living our faith can be challenging. Rather than be inspired and full of life, it is easy to feel depressed and isolated from God. The prophet Ezekiel describes this feeling.
The Spirit of the Lord set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, O my people, I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live.
God did put his spirit within us. We celebrate that at Pentecost. But before his spirit, he sent his son to be with us.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The young woman's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. How will this be? Mary asked the angel. Since I am a virgin. The angel answered, The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God.
Jesus was born just like any of us. He had a human mother, but God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, was his father. At about the age of 30, Jesus' public ministry began. He was baptized by John the Baptist, who had been preaching in the wilderness and warning people to repent and to turn to the Lord, for a new age was upon them.
And it came to pass that Jesus was baptized. And while he prayed, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven which said, You are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased.
In his ministry, Jesus healed the sick. He was accused of eating and drinking with outcasts and sinners. He opened the eyes of the blind, gave hearing to the deaf, and proclaimed the good news to all who would listen. In all things, he fulfilled God's gracious will.
Thank you.
In his teaching, Jesus helped people understand God and God's kingdom by telling stories. One of the stories he told was the parable of the wicked tenants. It is a parable that says much to us as we come to celebrate Easter, for it captures the essence of the story of creation and salvation. Listen to the words of the Gospel of Mark.
Jesus told this parable. A man planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a pit for the winepress, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants to collect from them some of the fruit of the vineyard. But they seized him, beat him, and sent him away empty-handed. Then he sent another servant to them. They struck this man on the head and treated him shamefully. He sent still another, and that one they killed. He sent many others. Some of them they beat, others they killed. He had one left to send, a son whom he loved. He sent him last of all, saying, "They will respect you, my son." But the tenants said to one another, "This is the heir. Come, let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they took him and killed him and threw him out of the vineyard.
This parable is really a story about us. God planted creation. God made us in his image. For generations, God sent prophets into the world. God spoke to us through these women and men, but we did not listen. Even when we did listen, we soon forgot. Then, when the time was right, Jesus came into the vineyard to reintroduce us to God. But there were those who did not want God's Son to disrupt their selfish world. They betrayed and crucified him. We will tell those stories again over the next 2 weeks. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and it is a day we mark Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. His triumphant entrance leads to Good Friday and the cross. But this is not a sad story. Jesus died so that our broken relationship with God might be healed. He died so that all the terrible things that human beings have done to each other and to creation might be forgiven and put aside. Listen to the words of the Gospel of John.
"For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life."
Thank you for joining us this morning. I hope you have heard your story in what we have been saying and singing. And I hope it helps to settle you in the vast uncertainty of the world in which we all live right now. Let us pray. Remember, Lord, your people bowed before you in prayer. Remember those who are on the internet with us, and those who are absent through age, sickness, or any other cause. Care for the infants, guide the young, support the aged, inspire the faint-hearted, and bring the wandering to your fold. Journey with the travelers, encourage the oppressed, defend the widows, deliver the captives, heal the sick. Strengthen all who are in tribulation, necessity, or distress. Remember for good those who love us, and those who hate us, and those who have asked us, unworthy as we are, to pray for them. Remember especially, Lord, those whom we have forgotten. For you are the helper of the helpless, the savior of the lost, the refuge of the wanderer, the healer of the sick. You know the need of all and have heard each prayer. Save us in your merciful, loving kindness and your eternal love. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.